thanks for organizing, for inviting me to Paris in this beautiful weather. So in the next 3 hours, we're going to give a tutorial on computational notions or computational analogues of entropy. It's going to be joint with Leo Reyzin sitting here. So we're going to split the first hour, and then the second hour Leo is going to speak, and then I'm going to come back in the third hour. So what is the plan? So in the introduction, in the first hour, we're going to speak a bit about entropy, standard notion of entropy, just to put the notations right between all of us and see that everyone understand. I'm going to formally define everything, but again, even for those of you know, still maybe it'd be good to set the notation right. Then we're going to motivate and give an informal description of two computational notions of entropy, which is pseudo-entropy and inaccessible entropy. And then we're going to give more facts and notations. So I'm going to give the first part, informal part, and then Leo is going to give the second part of this hour, more formal things and basic facts and lemmas. Then in the second hour, Leo is going to speak about pseudo-entropy. And the last hour, I'm going to speak about inaccessible entropy. So entropy. I'm going to define entropy by the notion of sample entropy. So given random variable x and the point little x in its support, the sample entropy of x at this point is simply log of 1 over the probability that x equals x. Okay? If you want to think about, is it the log of the surprise in the point x, given that you know that it's drawn from x? And then the well-known Shannon entropy for random variable is simply the expectation over the sample entropy. Again, the expectation over expectation over x of the sample entropy of this point. So you know, Shannon entropy, is, as you all know, play a major role in very, very different fields. We focus in a rather narrow aspect of Shannon entropy that you see in the talks. So you can think about the Shannon entropy for the random variable as the amount of randomness in the random variable. Okay? And this actually can be formalized precisely. So I'm going to state through this introduction a few facts that I think are important to remember about entropy. Definitely not going to state all important facts about entropy, only the very fundamental one, the basic one that you do have to keep in mind. And the first one I'm going to state is that if you add a random variable, it's only increase the entropy, or it cannot decrease the entropy. That is, sorry, what happened, I don't know. So if you consider the entropy of the jointly distributed random variable x and y, think about, is there one random variable, it only has more entropy, or not less entropy than the entropy of x by itself. Good, sorry, I have some problem with the timing. So I'm going to consider two variants of entropy. The first one is called the max entropy, which is simply the log of the support of the random variable. Okay? So the way you think about it, think that the random variable, the support, sorry, I have some problem with the timing, which anyone remember maybe I do re-ace timing and then it reality again too. Good. So, then I know how much time I have also. Good. So, if you want to think about it, if the support is simply over L bit string, then max entropy is simply the length of X. Okay? This is the right way to think about max entropy. I want to speak about mean entropy, which is more interesting notion. It's the sample entropy of the most likely element in the domain. Okay? The sample entropy of the most likely element. This is the main entropy for a random variable. And, it's important to remember this fact, that the mean entropy is always smaller equal than the entropy, than the Shannon entropy. This is because it's worst case entropy, where the entropy is always smaller equal than the max entropy, than the length of the random variable. And there's quality only if and only if X is uniform over its support. Good. We're only going to speak about a conditional entropy, and I'm also going to define for you the sample entropy. So given a jointly distributed random variable x and y, and the point x, y, so the sample entropy in x, given y, denoted like that, is simply a sample entropy of the random variable x condition y equal y at the point x. Or more explicitly, is log of the probability of x given y equal y. Okay, this is sample entropy at the point, and the sample entropy for random variable x given random variable y is the expectation of this quantity. Or its more known form is the expectation over y of the Shannon entropy of the random variable x given y equal y. Okay? And it's not hard to see that it's equal the entropy of x and y minus the entropy of y. Or putting it differently, it leads to what's called the chain rule of entropy, which is the entropy of x and y is simply the entropy of y plus the entropy of y given x. Of x given y, yes. Good. And finally, I'd like to remember that when you condition about a random variable, when x condition y, you do not increase the entropy. It's always bounded by the above by the entropy of x. This is this part, okay? Where you don't lose too much as well. You don't lose more than the length of y, okay? By sampling on y, by conditioning on y, you don't lose entropy, not more than the length of y. Good. So another fact is another notion we're going to use through this tutorial is the notion of statistical distance. So statistical distance between two distributions is formally simply the L1 norm between the distribution vector. But for this talk, I want to think about it differently. It's the distinguishing advantage of the best algorithm to distinguish between those two distribution. In what sense? In a sense that it's the difference between the probability that the algorithm output 1 where they get a sample from P and the probability that the algorithm output 1 where they get a sample from Q. Okay? So if you take the best algorithm, unbounded algorithm, that try to distinguish between two distributions, this equal to the statistical distance. And remember that I'm taking the maximal over all distinguishers. Later on, I'm going to introduce a new notion. They are going to take the maximal only over polynomial bounded distinguishers. Okay. So just a few more notions. I said distribution P is delta closed Q if its statistical distance is at most delta. Okay. And I also say that a distribution ensemble is indistinguishable from a different distribution ensemble. So here, the assembled distribution for every n, I have a pair of distribution, Pn and Qn. If the statistical distance between Pn and Qn converges to zero, but very strongly, it's smaller than 1 over poly for any polynomial. Or if you want to think about it, it's smaller to n to the minus log n. That's for the sake of the talk, it'd be fine. Okay? So again, two distributions are indistinguishable if when you go to infinity, they're very close to each other. And I'm also going to use, I said, statistical distance between random variable, where I merely mean that I'm taking the statistical distance between the distributions of this random variable. Okay. Good, so I finished my overview of information theoretic notions. Let me just say two facts, yes? So, it's smaller. You think about it, it's smaller than n to the minus log n.
Would you mean precisely n to the minus log n?
No, formally it's smaller than 1 over p for every polynomial p. But this is smaller than n to the minus log n, if you take to infinity. So, without getting too much detail, which are not important for this talk, you can think about when I say something negligible, it's n to the minus log n. It's not necessarily n to the minus n, which is very small, but it's smaller than any 1 over poly for any polynomial. Okay, that's it's very small. Okay, for this talk suffices. More questions? That's so. I speak quickly. I always speak quite quickly, but definitely when I speak in front of audience. And it's really important you ask questions. If I'm just notation is not clear or something else is not clear, or just I can got confused in something. Okay, so please go ahead and ask questions. Okay. Good. So that's two basic facts. First fact is what's called chain rule for mean entropy. There's no really chain rule for mean entropy. Yes?
Is
what?
N the support size of the distribution? What is N?
Not necessarily. N is just a parameter. Both are ensembles of distributions, because you know the statistical distance between two fixed distributions is some number, right? It cannot be negligible. It's 0.0001. If I want to speak about asymptotic terms, I have to speak about ensembles. Okay. So if you think about it, it's always going to be some security parameter. You can think about the security parameter if you like. And when it's large enough, the statistical distance goes to zero. Okay. Yes. Right, right.
I think they're n-bit random
variables. Yes, you can think about this n-bit random variable if you like. Okay, so two basic facts. First fact is chain rule for mean entropy. Remember the chain rule for entropy is when you condition a random variable where y, you don't lose more than the length of y. So there's not really a chain rule for mean entropy, which is more subtle notion. But there's like a chain rule for mean entropy, and never mind the characteristic graph formulation, it says the following. When you condition a random variable y, then for every number t with probability 2 to the minus t, you didn't lose more in the mean entropy than the length of y, like you would have lost if we speak about entropy, plus t. Okay? Again, you lose another t bits to make it happen, probability 2 to the minus t. Okay? So this is some analog of chain rule for mean entropy. Okay? You have to lose something, you have to give away an additional t bits, and then you only have mean entropy to be that high, probability 2 to the minus t, but in our settings be enough. Okay? So you lose somewhat, and then you still have chain rule for mean entropy. Okay? So Leo is going to, I think, speak more about chain rule this, but for the sake of for this very informal introduction, there's somewhat chain rule for mean entropy. Good, the second fact.
Sorry, what is L
doing
in that
theorem? Where's L?
L, that L doesn't
equal. It's T. L is T. Sorry. Good, the second fact is the well-known Haskell over S lemma, which says the following. You have run a variable, say, of n bit string, whose mean entropy is at least K. And now you take the inner product of this random variable with a random string, with a random independently n-bit string. What I mean inner product, I mean pointwise multiplications modulo 2. You take the sum of the pointwise multiplication and take modulo 2. Then the leftover SLM is the following. You can publish the random string that you inner product with. And then the inner product of this random variable with this n-bit string is very close, statistically close, to this n-bit string R, and a uniform independent bit. In some sense, if you want to think about it, I have a random variable with mean entropy K, I extract one bit of truly, not mean entropy, but uniform bit from X. Okay, I turn this mean entropy in X into a uniform bit. Okay, this is called the leftover Hash lemma. Again, it has a parameter, how close is distribution to this one, 2 to the 1 minus k over 2, okay? But if you think of k is large enough, then say log square, then it's negligibly close. The distribution are negligibly close one to each other, are statistically indistinguishable from each other, okay? So there's a way to extract. This was the basis for the field of extractors. There's a way to extract mean entropy for random variable and turn to uniform bit. Okay, you lose entropy, etc., but it doesn't matter for this point. And actually, you can extend it to many bits. You don't have to extract one bit. You can take random matrix, random vector, and then you extract more bits, and the price you pay is that the distance goes I with the number of bits you extract. Okay? Good. So I finished with the introduction to basic notions. Now, let's think about some application. So the best dreams of cryptographers always start like that, okay? There are two parties, Alice and Bob, and they share between them a random string, not known for everyone else but them, okay? If two parties, they can sit in different continent, share such string, they can do miracle between them. They can encrypt very efficiently a message to each other. They can authenticate one each other, etc. Okay? They can assume that they have their only own a private channel going out of the ocean, but they realize it using the internet. because they have this jointly shared random strings. Okay, so this like cryptographer best dreams, but as you know, even the best dreams sometimes they turn bad. And in the cryptographer scenario, they turn bad, there's some bad guy, Eve, who's tapwiring, or some, not tapwiring, he managed to say break into a Bob apartment and get some information about the key, okay? And the cops realize it by he got some function of the key, okay? And clearly if the function is simply the key itself, then we are dead. But in many settings, it's not the key itself, it's only some information about the bit, say the first half of the bit, half of the key, okay? Okay, so now, K is not completely hidden from the point of view of that for the eavesdropper, but is partially hidden. Okay, or if you want to, he has some mean entropy. Okay, and truly, what he said before, well, the key is not hidden from the point of view of the adversary, knowing f of the key, but with high probability, it has a lot of mean entropy. And if you think about it, m equal n over 4 and t equal 1 n over 4, so probability 2 to the minus n over 2, it has n over 2 bits of entropy, mean entropy, okay? And now what can we do? We cannot use key as is, because maybe the adversary knows the first half of the bits of the key. But what can we do? We can extract uniform bits from this key. This is exactly why we use extractor. So simply, Ali sends the random strings to Bob, and both parties set the new key to the inner product of the old key and these random strings. And now, the leftover lemma tells us the following. For the adversary, knowing f of the key, okay, because it stole it, and knowing these random strings, because it was sent clearly in the internet, still, the new key looks as is its uniform. From the point of view of the adversary, he thinks that the new key, he cannot distinguish between it and the uniform bit. Okay? So we can ask what you can do in one bit of key. So as I said, there's no reason to send one bit. You can send more strings like that, and then you can have like n over 4, you can have like n over 4 bits. Okay? It's not as good as it started with, but it's good enough. Yes.
The reason why you did this, why you don't work with average mean entropy, right?
Yeah, and that's to keep it simple, okay? So I know. No, okay. So no, I agree. Leo complained as well, but it was too late for change. Anyway, for Leo's going to put it in average mean entropy for me. I'm not going to get into details anyhow. So now we are in the good scenario as well, right? The parties managed to immune their key against this leakage, and now they have uniform key as well, and everything is good. But, cryptographers also in their dreams are somewhat realistic. There's no way that Alice and Bob are going to have really shared random string, right? How can it happen? I mean, Alice have to go to Bob, and if she speak with 100 Bobs, you have to go to each of him and exchange the key. So rather, what cryptographers do to decide of this truly uniform key which is hidden from the environment, we use some key agreement protocol, where it's a fancy name to say that using some cryptographic means, they exchange a secret key between them. And the simplest way to think about it is using public key in crypto systems. So Ali simply choose a pair of public key and secret key, sends the public key to Bob, Bob encrypts a random string and sends it back to Alice, and both of them set, and then Alice can decrypt because she knows the secret key, and both of them set the key to this new key, okay? So good, so now, well, we don't have a real uniform bit, but we have something that looks like uniform bit. But the problem is, now when you think about the scenario that the adversary learns f of k, we cannot argue this, we cannot use this argument any longer, because truly, from the adversary point of view, there's no entropy in the key. The encryption completely determines the key. It is true because it's computationally bounded. It cannot distinguish between uniform, maybe. But you cannot use directly information theoretic means to argue anything about the secrecy of the key, of the new key. Because again, the new key, not only that it doesn't have mean entropy, it is determined given the transcript. Okay? So this leads to that we need to use some different notion different terminology to argue about the secrecy of the new key in these settings. Okay? So again, you could use information theoretic means as long as we can, but when we move to using key agreement, everything breaks down. Okay? You cannot use this argument any longer. Okay, so this leads to the notion of pseudo-entropy, or pseudo-randomness. With pseudo-randomness, says the following. It says two distributions, before we said what pseudo-randomness, let's say the computation is distinguishable. Two distribution ensemble are computationally distinguishable if not computationally bounded adversary can distinguish between the two distributions. Again, in statistically indistinguishable, we said that no adversary can distinguish between them. Here, we relax this requirement and only require that two computationally bounded adversary cannot distinguish between them. And then we said that the ensemble P and the ensemble Q are computationally distinguishable. And P, the ensemble P is pseudo-random, simply if it's computationally indistinguishable from the uniform string over some domain n of size n. And pseudo-randomness is one of the fundamental key notions in cryptography and leads to actually in large part of theoretical computer science. In particular, they allow us to bypass, for those of you know what it is, the Shannon-bounded encryption key length. Okay? And let's see, if I said pseudo-randomness, let's say what pseudo-random generator is. It's simply a finishing algorithm that increases input length, and still its output over uniform input is pseudo-random. Okay, this is called pseudo-random generator. Simply output is pseudo-random, even though it's definitely not random, because its entropy is determined by the input length. Okay, and finally, let's go back to our example. If one uses public encryptions, then the security of public encryptions says the following. Given a random public key and the encryption of a public string, this is computationally distinguishable, and the string itself, computationally indistinguishable from the public key, the encryption of the string, and independent n-bit strings. Namely, given the encryption scheme and the public key, you cannot tell the encrypted message from truly random bits. Okay? Now we can go back to our example. I said the following. Well, the K key is not no longer uniform from the adversary point of view, but it is pseudo-random. And if it is pseudo-random, I claim, then also the new key is pseudo-random. And why is that? This is true because think about an adversary to distinguish the new key from uniform bit. You can very easily use it to distinguish the original key from uniform strings. So here, again, I have to use reduction. I say, assume there's a distinguisher that distinguishes the new key from the truly bit. I say, if the K key was uniform, then you could not. That's what we claimed before. And therefore, you cannot do now because we can use it to distinguish between the pseudo-uniform string K and key, sorry, K, and key and K, excuse me, and random bits, random strings. Okay? So what's happened here? We start with reconstructions who should work in the information theoretic settings. And then, because we use public encryption, we cannot longer use this as is. So we came up with the computational notion of entropy, in specific of pseudo-randomness. And this gives us two things. First, intuitively, we think that if something is pseudo-random, it's random. This is the intuitive level. And we act as if it's random. We use exactly the same tools as if it was random. This is the intuitive level. And then when we have to argue about security, we use the exact definition of what is pseudo-randomness. And because it's the right definition, it gives us also that what happened with a uniform string also happens with a pseudo-random string. So this, in a nutshell, the beauty of computational notion of entropy, they allow you to think as if you're in the information theoretic settings, where we have good intuitions, okay, and you have good tools. Use exactly these intuition and tools to work with computational notion of entropy, in our case, it's pseudo-randomness. And then, when you need to prove it, if everything is defined right, you can prove it as well.
What is capital R in here? So this, your sequence of quantifiers is not
Sorry, this R is simply the random n-bit string R.
Okay.
It uses an n-bit string. What the adversary does. No, it chooses at random. The adversary, he wants to distinguish between pseudo-random k and uniform strings. It chooses random string r, publish it in in a product with the k. This is x. Sorry, I didn't confuse it. So let me read it. This is the distinguish. Tell x from k from uniform. It does the following test. It takes this string, compute f of x, okay, and choose a random string r, okay, in a product this r with this string, and then give it the adversary that breaks the distinguish between this k nu and random bit, okay.
So what do you have in the box is some kind of proof, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Maybe the d is missing on the r.
Yes. Yes.
Sorry.
I'm bad. So let me say it right again. So D define D prime defined as following. D X, it chooses R, where R is chosen uniform from 0, 1 to the N. F of X. And the inner product of X R. And because D, we think that D can distinguish this from with the case of written U here, this is what we assume, then it's almost immediate that D prime distinguish between the case where it is K and is uniform. Okay? It's simple reduction. It's immediate. If this happens, namely K nu is not pseudo-random, then this happens. The new distinguisher D distinguish between the original string and the uniform string. Namely, the original string K wasn't pseudo-random. I'm restricting now F to be polynomial. Okay, it's true, it doesn't work. It was informal restricting F to be polynomial computable. Otherwise, D prime is not computable. Okay, so sorry for being informal. 25, so I still 5 minutes for Leo, it's fine. So more generally, you can relax this notion of pseudo-randomness and pseudo-entropy. Pseudo-entropy says the following, a random variable has pseudo-entropy K, if it's computationally distinguishable from a different random variable, or ensemble of random variables, such that this new random variable, Z, is truly entropy, is truly a Shannon entropy is K. Okay? Pseudo entropy is K if your computation is distinguishable for a different random variable whose entropy is K. Okay? And this is a powerful tool to use to argue about secrecy, as we see in the next hour. And it's interesting only if the pseudo entropy is larger than the real entropy, because you get pseudo entropy is equal to the entropy. You simply take z equal x. Okay, something interesting happens only if the entropy of z, which is computation distinguishable from x, is larger than the true entropy of x. Okay, this is the only interesting case. Good, and you can also speak about pseudo mean entropy, which is defined basically the same. We said random variable is pseudo mean entropy k if its computation is distinguishable from another random variable z whose truly mean entropy is k. Good. So should I go over the outer predicate because I want to speak about accessible entropy? So. So let me give you one example, or canonical example, for pseudo-entropy. So this involves one-way functions. So one-way functions are efficient computable functions that are hard to invert. No efficient algorithm can find a pre-image, any pre-image, with more than negligible probability. Okay, this is one-way function, and this is the assumption in cryptography. In the sense that if you have cryptography, I'm slightly exaggerating, but if you have cryptography, you have one-way function. Okay, it's the minimal understanding in cryptography. If one function does not exist, basically, large part of what we know about cryptography does not exist as well. And now I want to say something very amazing lemma. It's called the hardcore lemma, Goldach-Levin hardcore lemma. Say the following: you take a one-way function x, and you take a random input, okay, computed over random input, and you take also random string r. Okay, and you publish the random function f of x and this random string r. And now you inner product x with this random string. Okay, this is the left experiment, this one. This is computation indistinguishable from the same experiment, but now rather than taking the inner product, you output uniform bits. Okay? So now that if f was many to one, this was immediate by the leftover Resch lemma. Because given f of x, the mean entropy of x is I, and you can extract it. Where if f is one to one, then nothing is given by the leftover Resch lemma. It's given f of x, x is given, there's no, the mean entropy in x is zero. Okay, so you cannot extract zero mean entropy. So the interesting case is when f is one to one. And now, especially in this case, if you think about the pseudo-entropy of this variable, we know it's computation distinguishable from this random variable. What is the real entropy of this random variable? It's simply 2n plus 1. Because f of x is 1 to 1, it determines x, therefore I have the same entropy. R is simply uniform n-bit string independent, and u is a uniform independent bit. So this random variable, f of x, r, and the inner product of r and x, as pseudo mean entropy, n plus 2n plus 1, when its real entropy is simply 2n, right? Because it's determined by the input. So this is the main canonical example where when you assuming something, you have a gap between the real entropy of a random variable and its pseudo entropy. Okay, so two more minutes, and I said this is the first step to construct one of the fundamental results in the foundation cryptography, which is pseudo-random generator for one F function.
So your U, X, R, they're mutually independent.
Mutually independent. X and R are mutually independent, okay? And U, in this case, is also additional mutual information. But this is simply, if F is one-to-one, this is a deterministic function of X and R. Good. So I spoke about pseudo-entropy, which is the most natural notion of computational analog of entropy. But let me also, for 2 minutes, sorry, Leo, define a very different notion of entropy, which we call inaccessible entropy. So pseudo entropy is very related to secrecy. We're trying to hide something. Is it true that we cryptographers hide many things? The goal in life is to hide some information. But not only that, think about digital signature. In the digital signature, there's no privacy involved. You only like that no one else can sign something and claim that you. No one can fake your signature. So intuitively, it should relate to a very different notion of computation entropy. And indeed, it's very related to a notion of inaccessible entropy. So what is this inaccessible entropy? Let me give an example. So a collision-resistant function, it's very known cryptographic primitive, is a function family which is compressing. Its output length is shorter than the input. And still, efficient algorithm cannot find the collision. Okay? Even though there's many collisions, say if 2 to the k to 1, there's many collisions, efficient algorithm getting the description of the hash function cannot find collision. Okay? And, you know, maybe it exists, maybe it doesn't. But if it exists, I want to think about the following generator. This generator getting from the world, from the outside, a random hash function. And now it flips, it chooses a random string, output the hash value of the string, namely output y equal h of x, and then it output x. Okay, this is a very simple game. It gets the hash function, output h of x, and then output x. Now, since the hash function is shrinking, it is easy to argue that the entropy of x, given the hash function and the hash value, is k, if h is k to 1. Okay? But what is the real, what is the entropy of x given g's point of view? Think of g. G, or even a cheating g, g already output y. Okay? Now, we have the output x, which is the preimage of y, okay? What freedom does it have? I claim that there's no way it can to output, even if flip as many random coins as you like, and not output two strings that are preimage of y. Why is that? Because if it could, it would break the collision resistance. It would do it twice and find two strings. right? So the point of view of the generator, even if it cheats, even if it doesn't act like the real generator, it tries to flip additional bits, the entropy of X4, his point of view, is zero. Let me put it more explicitly. So if it's a cheating generator, it doesn't act like the real generator is. It just flips some random bits and output Y. Now it chooses addition, Y can be arbitrary. But now you choose a different set of random strings and output X, but we do restrict him that X is going to be pre-image of Y, okay? And now what is the entropy of X given what the generator knows at this point? He knows H because he got it from the outside. He output also, he knows R because he already flipped it. And he knows Y, okay? So what is the entropy of X from his point of view? So I claim that from his point of view, the entropy is zero, or essentially zero. Sorry. Oi. Okay. I always think there's another line there. So the entropy is zero, or close to zero. And again, because for his point of view, if you could output two strings, then you could simply break the collision resistance. Okay, so this is the last slide. So how do we measure this phenomena? How do we measure the fact that we want to think that the entropy of X that can be sampled by efficient algorithm is smaller than the real entropy in X? A false attempt would be to say, look, this is the entropy, the pseudo entropy is at most k, if you cannot distinguish it from random variable. Thanks, Moni. So I claim that the accessible entropy is most k if its computation is distinguishable from random variable, which the entropy is at most k. Okay, like the natural analog of pseudo-entropy. But it turns out this is a very bad definition. Anyone can tell why? Why it's not what we're looking for? Anyone didn't look at the slide when it was there for a second? So the reason is that any random variable is computationally distinguishable from a different random variable with very low entropy. Okay, this can be used in similar probabilistic methods. So basically, this definition would tell us nothing about the random variable. So it's useless. Rather, we're going to use formalize the following definition. X is inaccessible accessible entropy k if any efficient generator trying to generate X, the entropy of its output is going to be at most k. Again, X, real entropy of X might be very large, but for efficient algorithm, trying to generate it is very limited. You cannot get full entropy. You only get k bit of entropy. And I'm going to formalize it in the third hour. So okay, sorry for the Liu. And now, yes, sir.
Good. So I'm going to try to make some of the things that Iftach said a little bit more a little bit more formal, and also just to emphasize, this part is a tutorial. So unlike other talks, it's for people who don't yet know the material. And that means, and that means, please feel free to stop me, as much as you want. Okay, and actually, the first part that I'm going to do is not even going to be about computational entropy. I'm going to talk about statistical entropy, information theoretic entropy of the kind that I like, which is min entropy, which I use a lot because the second half of the week is going to have a lot of similar applications to what I'm going to talk about now that are information theoretic, the key agreement application, key establishment application. So sort of to try to at least figure out what the differences in language are between what I'm going to be doing today and what we're going to be talking about in a couple of days. I think it would be helpful. So I'm going to try to advertise min entropy as the notion you often want. So what min entropy is good for is essentially measuring secrecy, right? So if I have a password, and half the time my password is 12345, and the other half the time my password is a very long and very good random string, It has very high Shannon entropy. It's hard to compress, right? Because half the time you can't compress it. But it's still very easy for you to guess. So the min entropy is the notion that you care about if you're worried about, you know, your password being guessed. So min entropy, just to remind you, but it's like it's the smallest surprise in the distribution, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is not a surprising password. That's the small surprise. That's the one the adversary is going to go for. And another way I want to think about it, it's the log of the probability that the adversary predicts the sample, right? If you're the adversary, you just want to predict, you have one chance to guess my password, you're going to go for the maximum probability one. That's the entropy measure I want. And this sort of functional definition is useful later. So think of it that way. To emphasize, right, it's Shannon is average surprise, and this is the sort of the smallest surprise, and that's important. Okay. So I want to talk a little bit about what min entropy is good for. So passwords already discussed. Here's a nice application to message authentication that some of you may have heard. So let's say my key for a message authentication, it's a symmetric system, right? I want to authenticate a message to you. We both have this key W. Okay, let's split it up into two parts, call them A and B. So think of this as an n-bit key. This is n over 2, this is n over 2. Okay. And let's think of them as, you know, elements of the appropriate finite field. They live in GF 2 to the n over 2. Let's say I have a message, and here's what I'm going to do to it. It's a very specific construction. Don't worry about the details, but this is so simple that it's a shame not to show. I'm going to multiply my message by A, so the message is n over 2 bits. Everything works in GF 2 to the n over 2. Multiply my message by A and add B and declare that to be my authentication tag. Right, so when I send my message, I'm going to send it together with this tag sigma. Okay. And the key is secret, right? And the point is that the adversary won't be able to modify the message without being detected with high probability. How many people have seen this construction? I'm just trying to understand the sort of the audience. How many people have seen this? How many people have not seen this? Okay, good. So those of you who have seen this, take a nap, and others ask me questions. This was actually, right, this was observed by Wegman and Carter in 81 as an application of their universal hash functions. Universal hash functions come from algorithms, from data structures, but then they're like, oh, they're also useful for security. And this starts a lot of security research. So I haven't said anything actually about entropy yet. If the key is uniform, then Wegman and Carter show that this is a good message authentication code.
What do you mean by message authentication?
Okay, so message authentication code means I'm going to send a message to you. We both share the same secret key. And Yevgeny, being the adversary, wants to modify the message, does not know the secret key. And now he has to modify the message in sync with the sigma, because you're going to verify that the sigma is correct. Right? Any modification to the message has to be reflected also in the sigma, otherwise you're going to detect. And the point is that it's going to be hard for him. It's going to be, I'll specify exactly how hard in a second. Okay. Good question. More questions? Okay. Here's a nice fact, which I'm not going to prove, but it's nice to think about. So imagine that you have min entropy of this key. So the key is n bits long, right? Imagine min entropy is k. And I'm going to think, which is an incorrect way to think about it, but a pictorially convenient way, that the min entropy is here, and this is the part that doesn't have entropy. Even though that's not what I'm, right? This is for all strings of min entropy k, but it's a nice way of thinking about it. And so what's not k, it's n minus k, is called entropy deficiency. Right, it's how far you are from a perfectly uniform string. And Maurer and Wolf, about a little over 10 years ago, proved that actually the security of this construction is in this bricked part. The security is how much you have over half. Right? So how difficult will it be for Yevgeny to modify the message that I'm sending 2 to the minus this? Right, this is the security value. So if this is 100, if n over 2 minus entropy deficiency, if these bricks are 100 bits, then it's going to be 2 to the negative 100. That's the probability that he will successfully modify this tag. Okay. So even if the key is not truly uniform, as it was in the Wegman-Carter 81 paper, even if the key only has min entropy, no matter where this min entropy lives in the key, right, for any distribution of keys that has min entropy, this is going to be secure as long as min entropy is somewhat greater than half. As soon as you reach over half, you get security. Okay, so that's a nice application. An application that Iftach talked about, and I'm going to rehash a little bit in a different language, is key agreement, also known as randomness extraction. Okay, so what is, let me just slightly more formally state what a randomness extractor is. It's an algorithm, this box is an algorithm. In comes my secret that is from a distribution of some min entropy, and also a uniformly random public string called a seed. So secret, public, right, that's important. And good, the secret part has some min entropy, the public part is uniform, and out comes a uniform string. So an extractor is an algorithm of these properties. Iftach showed one extractor that gets you a uniform bit, just one, by taking a dot product, bitwise dot product, mod 2. Okay, that's that's one extractor. There are more of them. I'll actually show a very simple construction. But here's a very important fact, that the seed, this public seed, does not ruin the uniformity of R. It's like a catalyst. You can reuse it. It participates in the reaction, but you can then use it again and again and again. So this public seed is only needed to get the uniform bits out of this min entropy string. You don't get exactly uniform. You get what's called epsilon close to uniform. A statistical distance that Iftach defined from the uniform distribution will be epsilon. Okay, where epsilon, I'll sort of talk about how much you use. And the point is that the seed is public and reusable. Yes. Oh, 5 minutes. Good. Okay, and who exactly started the extractor work is not so clear, and there are lots of references that one can give. Here's the simplest construction so that you have something concrete to talk about. Just compute the product. Now, we did the dot product. Now let's do a different product. Let's just multiply. Imagine this is n bits and this is n bits. Multiply them together and truncate. Okay? Lifting my laptop won't help. I see that people can't see. multiply I times W and truncate. To how many bits do you truncate, right? Well, you're hoping to get something uniform, so certainly no more than K. And in fact, you have to pay a little bit to get uniformity. You pay relative to epsilon. So let's say you want something that's, you know, you're getting statistical security. If you're worried about things that happen 1 in a trillion times, then you're worried too much, right? 1 in a trillion is 2 to the negative 40. And that's good enough as far as proximity to uniform, let's say. I'm making numbers up right now, right? But it's good numbers to keep in mind. So if you want to get 2 to the negative 40 close to uniform, then you're going to have to lose 80 bits, 2 times 40. Because that's what this 2 log 1 over epsilon means. If you want to get 2 to the negative 100 close to uniform, you're going to lose 200 bits. And if you're worried beyond that, then you're not in the right business, probably. You lose somewhere between 50 and 200 bits. That's sort of the reality of it. From going to entropy to close to uniform. Okay. Good. So one application, then we'll take a break. Let's think now about privacy simplification, which is also known as key agreement. Alice and Bob have W, which is not fully uniform. And Eve knows something, let's call that random variable, what she knows, capital Y, about your W. That was the setting that Iftach had, where we had some leakage to Eve. And Alice and Bob want to agree on a uniform secret R. There's no public infrastructure. There's no computational assumptions. Information theoretic for now. Now that we have randomness, and the setting is sort of goes back, you know, all the way to 1975. Given today's language, we know the right solution for this problem. You just need to use an extractor, right? So Alice will find an extractor seed. It's uniformly random. She'll just generate it on her own. She'll pass the thing through an extractor, get R, send the seed. Remember, it's OK for the seed to go to Eve because it can be public. And Bob will do the same thing. And we're going to end on a cliffhanger, right? What's the right value? When you use extractors, you have to know what k is so that you can extract k minus 2 log 1 over epsilon bits. That's what we said last time. How many bits do you need to extract? And we're going to end on this and take a break.